Kolinsky, major, Dr. Angelo Vivenna, who is the head of Quonset Consolve and contact lecturer of quantitative finance at the Cornell University. Dr. Vivenna has worked out pioneering results in the field of quantitative methods applied to the surveillance of financial markets, focus on insider trading analysis, market abuse detection, and the risk disclosure of structured products through synthetic indicators. And he has been writing several publications, and it is good for us Italians to quote a book in Italian, La moneta in computa, How do you translate the unfinished money, which has been published in 2013, and of course relates to the euro. And his lecture is actually on this topic today, which is the incomplete currency, the future of the euro and possible solutions. No need to say that it is a very, very hot topic, and we hope to learn how to act in the future. So, I'm very pleased to give the floor to Dr.
Thank you. Let me firstly thank you for your kind invitation, and after your introduction I feel a bit of responsibility now. I hope to give some insights. I don't know if I will be able to sketch some reasonable solution, but at least it's my good way. More or less 1 year ago, on Risk Magazine, I wrote that the Eurozone needs to be cured. And actually, I was referring to the spread phenomenon, because, you know, at the moment we are quite used because about these information, the spread between the Italian Treasury and the German Bund. Every day we receive this information from the media, and it seems quite a normal indicator. Actually, we have learned at economy, I think, the first course during the degree economics, that it's not normal that one currency area has 25-26 interest rate debt structure. It should be the other way around. You have one currency area, you have one interest rate debt structure. And, you know, this is not actually what is happening. But at the beginning of the euro, it was exactly that the case. In more or less 7-8 years, we experience what I like to call the Germanization of the interest rate term structure of the Eurozone. So all the interest rate, this slide that you have, the 10 years government bond rate, tends to converge towards the German level. And finance plays an important role in the convergency trades in order to give this result. Because it was quite obvious that if you would have one currency, you need to have one interest rate term structure. And this brought several good things for the Eurozone. One phenomenon in terms, you know, of Eurozone cycles convergency, correlation between the economies of the different Eurozone countries, and one important phenomenon, the public debt Europeanization. So in other words, as you can see within this histogram, the public debt, for example, of Italy was held also by the other countries of the Eurozone. And for Greece, for example, they have to have 90% of the debt, of their public debt, held by foreign countries. In other words, the unification of the Eurozone was happening. And this kind of unification has behind the uniqueness of the interest rate term structure. Unfortunately, this nice story receives a certain point an important stop. The international crisis immediately transmitted from US to Eurozone. But why this? Several reasons, but let me offer you the perspective of, let's say, the risk analyst. The problem of this crisis is that is a real estate crisis, such as the largest part of the crisis within the economics in the last century, I would say, driven by the real estate crisis. But in this case, that crisis was amplified by the usage of derivatives, because these risks were embedded in structured products with a big lack of credit risk measurements. Look, not a problem of the quantitative analysis. The problem was that this kind of risk was definitely misspecified within the bank's financial institution by starting from the hypothesis that the credit risk was substantially absent. Yes, present in some conference of quotes, but nothing more than that. And why this crisis then transmitted immediately to Europe? Because Europe found its perfect storm. Because within the Eurozone, and actually we experienced the worst decline after the Second World War in terms of GDPs, I was saying in Europe, the credit risk was not measured at all within the government's debt. There were several directives, Basel, Solvency and UCITS, that just saying the risk is equal all over Eurozone, even if it was false. And you know, till the financial markets would believe this thing, the interest rate was unique within the Eurozone. No discrimination for the treasury, for the government bonds issued by the different Eurozone countries. But when it appears to be a problem within the credit risk measurements, obviously it's not the fact that I like to read the word the attack of financial markets towards one country. No? It seems like film, you know, those films of the 50s where there are these ants, dicks, and they were attacking the humans. It's not an attack, it's just the fact that at a certain point in time the markets realize we have a problem there. The risk is not measured and the Eurozone is not homogeneous on that dimension. So they found the perfect storm. And then the story that you know, correlation between the banking system, government system, and all the things that we know very well, so let me skip about it. The picture of the interest rate and structure changes immediately. We need 8 years with the help of convergence trades, so the finance helps to converge the interest rate and structure within the Eurozone. In just 3 years, the finance decided that the interest rate should diverge. And now, we think that it's normal that Italy is a spread with respect to Germany, France with respect to Germany, Spain with respect to Germany, whatever, and that every country within the same currency area display a different interest rate and structure. Actually, it's not normal at all. At all. And this determines several implications or negative aspects. Let's call implication to be a little bit more politically correct. The first implication is what I like to call the shadow currencies. We are living in a zone, in a Eurozone, where the euro does no longer exist within the financial markets. The interbanking system settles with the shadow currencies. Let me show you this concept. Before the crisis, and actually before the euro, as you can see in this slide, where you have the spread between the Italian treasury and the German treasury, the blue line, and the green line is the exchange rate between the Italian lire and the Deutsche Mark. These two measures, through the interest rate parity theory, would represent, in a certain sense, a full picture of the German and the Italian economics. Because all the dynamics of the balance of payments, financial account, balance of trade, you know, are in a certain sense adjusted through these two quantities. All the financial risks were represented by these two dynamics. Now, this is the situation. The exchange rate does no longer exist. And for a long time, before the crisis, we did not have a spread between the Italian treasury and the German treasury. But once the spread arose, what's happened is that immediately the market realized that they need another exchange rate. This time able to compensate just for the credit risk. That is the variable that has to be determined in order to solve the problem that comes from the US crisis. And we see a spread between the Italian CDS, the credit default swap, and the German credit default swap. So in other words, while in the past, the exchange rate and spread between the two treasuries was represents the full picture of the economics of the two countries. Now, since we are in a fixed exchange rate regime between Italy and Germany, because we share the same currency, the financial markets found a way out to quote the credit risk between the CDS spread. And it's also interesting to see that the attitude of this indicator, the red line, is not very different from the exchange rate on the, that we saw in the green color. What's more, the financialization of the economy. In average, in Europe, the economy worth 10 times, the economy that has been financialized, worth 10 times the real economy. In Holland, 20 times. What does it mean? It means that I can buy for 1 euro my coffee, that is the real economy, more or less in all the European capital. But the interbanking system is already settling with different currencies that are the settling by using the European interest rate plus the spread. And so since this part of the capital flows worth 10 times the real economy, I think that we are living with shadow currencies. There is a second implication behind this point. You know, when the spread arrives, the discrimination of the collateral appears within the market. In other words, one thing within the repo market is to make a repo by using as a collateral a bond. One thing is if you use as a collateral a Greek bond, government bond, or a Spanish or an Italian one. The spread discriminates the amount of money that you can receive when you try to be financed within the interbanking system. And this creates a contradiction in terms, because the European Central Bank, apart from a period, let me use this word, of confusion, in which also the European Central Bank, in order to boost the European crisis, but they were not aware about that, in my opinion, decided to start also the discrimination of the Eurozone bonds. Thanks to God, it works for 6-7 months. before the big crisis of July 2011. And I will spend some words after this reasoning on this fact. You know, if the European Central Bank's bank plays his role of a credit risk hedger of last resort, so in other words, you can post within the central bank as a collateral whatever government bonds of the Eurozone you want, you will receive the same money in terms of financing. So it's a credit risk hedger of last resort. It means, and this is a contradiction in terms, that when the gypsy banks needs money and they have exhausted their capability of financing through the European Central Bank, they have to go within the market. Within the market, they have to post as a collateral their govies. The govies are discriminated. And then the German banking system that still has margin to go to the European Central Bank, because we know that the European Central Bank lends money according to the dimension of the banking system, and the biggest banking system in Europe is the German one, they can gain a spread intermediation. So the European Central Bank that should be the subject that guarantees the homogeneity, the uniformity of the Eurozone, that keeps the Euro still alive, becomes a cash cow for the German banking system by allowing the spread intermediation. And let me now spend the word that I promised you 2 minutes ago about that period. In February 2011, the president of the European Central Bank decided to accommodate this collateral discrimination. In that moment, the spread started to grow, and in July 2011 we finish, you know, the euro as we have built 11 years before, because the spread arrived at level 400-500. But why that decision has been so important for the financial market, for causing the financial market attack? Because in that moment, the financial markets realized that neither the European Central Bank was still believing in the Eurozone. That was the message for the risk analyst of the investment banks. Because if you are the subject that should guarantee that all the govies are equal, and you started to say, if you want money from me, if you come from Greece, I give you 40 over 100 of collateral. If you come from Portugal, 70. If you come from Germany, 100. If you come from Italy, 95. These figures are not true, but just to give you an idea. It is clear that the market received an important signal. Another important signal was in year 2009, when in Germany arrived the first bank default, the IKW, because the first bank that went bankruptcy after the subprime crisis, because they were, it was full of structured product, actually garbage, was a German bank. But at that time, it arises an important declaration of the Chancellor Merkel that says, look, another signal for the market, another move in the Italian spread. And the declaration was, we are in year 2009. Each member country will take care of its bank defaults. So in other words, the market that till the time was believing in Basel, solvency, in UCITS directives, so in other words, in a regulation environment where all the banks should be saved by the euro system, realized that the euro system was not present at all. Implication of this, from the Europeanization of the public debt, we move to the nationalization of the public debt. So in other words, each Eurozone member country started to work for itself. each banking system was required to buy its treasuries. And look, the bankruptcy of Spain in 2012 is due to this phenomenon, because the banking system was not able to cover this phenomenon, even if the public debt was not so high in Spain. But the system has not assets able to cover the needs for nationalizing the public debts. This picture is quite clear about what is debt nationalization for Italy. The debt owed by Italian banks, the blue line grows, the red line declines. And look, the LTROs, the long-term refinancing operations of the end of 2011, beginning of 2012, just served to this scope in Italy, as you can see from this graph. And in fact, if we just compare the loans to private with the debt held by banks, with creating this indicator that I call the real economy support index, we see that when the LTRO is arrived, the loans decline. So in other words, no money were given to the real economy, because this money serves to nationalize the Italian public debt. Another implication of this interest rate term structure disaggregation is within the competitiveness of the European countries. There is just one man show. The Germany displayed a positive surplus for more or less 10-12 years, and the other Eurozone countries displayed important deficits. Don't be deceived by 2013 data, because these surpluses are just a collapse of the imports. But let's try to understand the drivers of this surplus, because definitely we have to accept that they produce very good quality products. But actually it's tough to believe that they produce very high quality products in all the possible fields. Also in the fields where you produce, you know, products that are perfect substitutes, like that glass of plastic. So there should be something more to be analyzed. First point, a difference of inflation. Yes, the European Central Bank has a smart target in terms of inflation of 2%. But in average. So in other words, the different Eurozone countries display different inflation. And if we compute in average this excess of inflation of the different countries with respect to Germany, for example, Greece has an average of 1.2% higher inflation. And you know, since when you produce goods, you produce with capital and labor, and you have to pay the capital with the interest, it is clear that you have an higher inflation, you have higher interest to pay. And it has an impact on your competitiveness. You cannot do nothing. If we add to this, you know, difference in inflations, the phenomenon of the spread, actually is several times the inflation differential between the Eurozone countries and Germany, because in Italy or Spain we arrive at the level of 5-6%, it's not a surprise that the cost of funding for our industrial sector arrived to have a 2% of difference with respect to Germany. And we are not speaking about labor productivity, no, we are just speaking about money, financial interest, that's it. And let's not speak about the sovereign spread, because for the sovereign spread, the picture becomes definitely worse. But I want to give you some figures in order to be more clear. Let's take the optical fibers. It's a perfect substitute product. Okay, there is no longer a technological gap to produce this. It's a very mature market for them. And we are a US citizen that wants to buy optical fibers. And they can buy this from Germany or from Italy. And in 1999, the price was $10. Now, we make the hypothesis that the German and the Italian factories does not reduce wages, move the factories in Poland, these kind of things. They just apply the differential of inflation and of spreads on the selling price for the next 13 years. The result is this one. So in other words, the Italian factory has a price of 13.6, while the German factory of 11.7. So there is a difference of 20% that obviously put the Italian factory out of the game. And for that German glass, you will not buy from the factory, I don't know, in Orvieto, but you will buy from the factory in Munich. Because you cannot cover 20% only with, wages, the localization, and this kind of stuff. You start with this, and then you move the other way around. But there is another driver. The euro, as I mentioned before, and actually I explained also why, works as a fixed exchange rate regime. In this picture, I use the color to depict the situation of the trade surpluses and deficits of the European, of the Eurozone countries. And so I'm just translating this picture, okay, on a cumulative basis over the time. It's not a surprise that more or less only Germany is in surplus, okay? What happens when a country is systematically in surplus? What we have studied in economics? Easy. There is an increase for the currency of that country. And with this increase of currency demand, obviously there is a currency appreciation for that country. Look at the color in the other Eurozone. And then the products becomes relatively more expensive due to the exchange rate adjustment. And eventually the trade surplus goes to zero. This is what has happened between Japan and US several decades ago. Unfortunately, the euro does not work in this way, because if you buy a Volkswagen, you buy a euro, not Deutschmark, just to simplify an example. And so this kind of adjustment does not show any result. The picture is clear. The German's export increases and the Italian export decreases. Another implication. The Eurozone public debts, in my opinion, are substantially in foreign currency. Are denominated not in a domestic currency. You know, before the euro, any central banks could control the money offer. But with the eurozone, the central banks has transferred the monetary sovereignty to the European Central Bank. And we study that when you cannot control the money offer of your country in order to govern, let's say, the dynamics of the public debts, is like that the public debts is denominated in another currency. And let me then quote some results of what happens in countries that has their debt denominated in a foreign currency. Almost 36 cases of defaults when the weight of the foreign currency public debt goes above or around, in average, 70% of the GDP. Below in this you have the picture for the Eurozone. Actually, not encouraging. And what happens in Argentina is definitely very well known. They have a debt denominated under a currency that has a fixed exchange rate with dollar. It was denominated in a foreign currency. They defaulted. And they are still speaking now about how to rearrange this last part of the debt, because obviously financial markets makes a speculation. A further implication requires me to recall the interbanking settlement system target 2. The picture is definitely embarrassing. During the peak of the crisis, within this system, we display more or less Germany that has a credit of 750 billion of euros with respect to the countries of the periphery that, according to people from UK, are denominated PX, very nice name, but it's not definitely much more better the name that the German people give to this country, Gypsy. I would like to find an acronym that better represents something, not these, you know, two solutions. Anyway, what does it mean? Why this is a problem? Actually, it's not definitely necessarily a problem. Also, in US, within their interbanking system, they have displayed important imbalance between the different Federal Reserves within the United States, within the USA. But in this case, it's a problem for what I will explain now. Let me just recap how does it work. There is an Italian bank and a German bank. They have a debt credit of 100. Okay? This is their accountability. At a certain point in time, the Italian banks receive the money, the ELTROs, to repay his debt towards the German bank. But when the Italian bank repays his debt, there is a credit risk transferring towards the euro system. Because it's Bundesbank now that has a credit of 100 with respect of the Bank of Italy. So if, as an accountant, you can see, okay, this is only an accounting trick. No. In terms of risk, now this 100 credit of Bundesbank with respect to the Bank of Italy are guaranteed by the euro system. So what does it mean? It means that with the target 2 payment system, we have a credit risk mutualization mechanism anytime the Italian or the Spanish, or in other words, the countries that have a negative target 2 net balance, settles their and repay their debts towards the country that is in positive net balance on target 2. It is Germany. That is important because you know that we cannot speak, otherwise Mr. Weidmann would immediately be upset about public debt risk mutualization. But the target 2 net payment system realize systematically the German credit risk mutualization. So it is true that with the ELTRO, Mario Draghi has saved the European banking system, but by firstly saving the German banking system. Let me show you this a little bit better. This is the, this picture represents the credits of German banks towards the Eurozone. You see a peak at 2009, and it's not a surprise that in 2012, in other words, when the ELTROs completely display and show their effects within the interbanking system, this credit goes substantially to zero. So in other words, the German banks has granted a lot of credits towards the Eurozone, I don't know if they have correctly measured the credit risk of this policy, but at a certain point in time arrives the European Central Bank, and the German banks were able to deleverage their credit risk towards the Eurozone. And it's not a surprise that in the last two, three semesters, since the gypsy banks or the PX banks are repaying back the ELTROs towards the European Central Banks, that Germany is again growing its credit towards the Eurozone. It's a nice cycle for them for some reasons that I will show you now. Firstly, in year 2012, 94% of the systemic credit risk of the German banking system has been transferred towards the Eurozone, because now it's a credit of Bundesbank, and this credit is guaranteed by the Euro system. Secondarily, it has an implication in the trade balance. This is the cumulative current account. In other words, are the trade surplus of Germany accumulated, okay, over time. It's not a surprise that this histogram displays a growing trend, because Germany displayed a surplus, has displayed a surplus for the last 12, 13 years. Now let's cross this information, let me forgive me for the change of scale, with the credits. So, the German banks actually are financing their exports, what we have studied as a vendor financing scheme. And when the credit risk becomes too high, they have to deleverage, arrive the central bank, and so they are in the position to apply a credit recovery scheme, whilst the vendor financing scheme continues to go on. And, obviously, when the ELTROs are reimbursed, they need to expand again their credit. It's interesting to see that this vendor financing cycle is working very well for them, definitely, due to all the reasonings that we have done before about the spread, the cost of lending for our industries, and so on. Let me break down the previous pictures of the current account and of the credits with respect to the contribution of the different Eurozone countries. And you can see that in this last vendor financing cycle, in other words, the new increase in credit of the German banking system towards Eurozone in order to finance their exports, there is a big contribution of France. It's not a surprise. In Italy we have 66 million of poor people. So there is a lack of demand. And France is replacing this. Now is France one of the sheep of the famous Bakun statement about the fact that when you are in a fixed exchange rate regime and you have just one currency, you are on a boat with a lion. You need a lot of ships to finish. And after the gypsy, now is the turn of France. And if you look at the flows instead of the stock, you can see that the picture becomes more clear, because it has not the heritage of the stock dynamics. And it's not a surprise that obviously the credit granted by German banking system towards France is growing in terms of stock and in terms of flows. And the picture is completed by looking at France trade surplus. Actually, deficit. It's the only country that has a deficit, because they still have a demand to supply the purchase of German goods. So let me summarize. The Targetung payment system and the ELTROs have an impact on the real economy of the Eurozone. Allow Germany to finance their trade surplus under vendor financing scheme. Transfer the risk of its banks on the European system of central banks. Allowed GIPSI to pay their debts to Germany, to nationalize the sovereign debt. It's not only France that is financing, that it belongs to the vendor financing scheme. Since obviously the German factories are quite aware about the fact that sooner or later the Eurozone will collapse, because it's a very slow agony if there will not be any important reactions of the Euro system. And I will try to show you how, in my opinion, they are moving outside Europe. As you can see from the cumulative current account now on a worldwide basis, you can see that there is an increase of the share of the rest of the world in their trade balance. And it's not this is the flow, and it's not a surprise that the credit granted by the German banking system outside the Eurozone is growing. In fact, the quote of the Eurozone moves from 75% to more or less 42-43%. So the vendor financing scheme now is moving on a worldwide basis. Important implication also on what Mario Draghi will decide today. You know, within a Eurozone vendor financing scheme, it is clear that the ETROs are the perfect mechanism. The Eurozone banks can ask for the ETROs, and the ETROs are used to repay their debt towards the banking system, the German banking system. But if now the vendor financing scheme moves on a worldwide scale, it is clear that the credit are no longer towards the Eurozone, and so are no longer towards the Eurozone banking system, but towards banks that are not second, that are not located in our Eurozone. It means that we have to find a solution to the leverage, the credit risk of German banks with a tool that allows also to credits that are not within the Eurozone to join these new policy measures. And so the quantitative easing is the perfect scheme when it will involve the cartolarization of credits, asset-backed securities, collateral loans obligation. Because this kind of cartolarization does not look at the nationality of the subject. So in other words, if I am a German bank and I am full of credits, without respect of their nationality, I can structure these credits within ABS or CLO, and they can bring this CLO at the European Central Bank, or to sell it, or just to use as a collateral to finance me. So why the ETROs was perfect in a moment in which the vendor financing scheme was completely developed within the Eurozone? It cannot work in a situation in which these credits are granted outside the Euro area. And so this could be a reason why the quantitative easing found, you know, the agreement of all the Eurozone member countries, Germany included, because it will allow the leveraging of credits granted by the banking system outside Europe. The exchange of this is obviously the TLTROs. These financing operations that on the sheet should be dedicated towards the real economy, but actually are without any kind of enforcement rules if you will not do it.
It was too strong a sentence, that one. You brought it. Just that moment that you tried to.
In the meantime, there is a map. I think I can continue in order to keep the audience alive.
Yes.
Another implication of this interest rate term structure disaggregation is given by the fact that the market started to quote, by using the CDS spread, the Euro breakup probability. You remember that the 1st of December 2012, Governor of Bank of England, King, declared that we are ready for the Euro breakup. And a lot of journalists in Italy was saying, what? I mean, it's strange that the governor makes a similar sentence. Actually, that sentence has a figure behind. In that moment, the probability of Euro breakup was around 70%. How to estimate this quantity? You know, in Europe, for our sovereign, we have two kinds of CDS. The CDS is an insurance towards the risk of default of the government. You pay a premium, you receive insurance for that, nothing more than that. But the CDS can be settled in euro, and so you are just hedging the default risk of that country, or can be settled in dollar. And in this case, obviously, the premium is higher, because you are just not hedging yourself from the default of that country, but also from the fact that the euro will no longer exist, and so you settle this transaction in dollar. Have I been clear? So, if I just subtract these two premium, I have the premium of the euro breakup protection. And obviously, by standard quantitative analysis, I can infer the euro breakup probability. Let me show you something. For Spain, that is a big country, in other words, if Spain would go bankruptcy, the euro, actually, I don't think that it would remain as it is, okay? When we have that important banking crisis in 2012, the market stops to trade the CDS settled in euro, but just in dollar. Because obviously the financial markets knows that if the European Stability Mechanism, the European Central Bank, would have not given 100 billion of euro to the Spanish banking system in order to save the country from the default, what hedge gives me a CDS that settles in euro? Nothing. And let me show something new, very embarrassing. In Italy, is no longer traded after the beginning of the crisis, the CDS in euro. It just exists the one in dollar. Because if Spain is a problem, Italy is definitely a pain in the neck. And by making some quantitative analysis, we can infer from this CDS quantum spread the probability that euro could break up. And as I told you before, when King makes the declaration, we were at the peak of 70%. Obviously, the decay is the OMT, policy measures of the European Central Bank. Eventually, something that tells to the financial markets that euro should persist and that Mario Draghi would not become the first unemployment person of the euro system. In finance, when you have the probability, you can compute the losses, the expected losses. It's quite a standard token. By using this analysis, we can estimate that at the peak of the crisis, the estimate of the losses embedded in the euro breakup was something like 200 billion euros. Actually, more or less, a weighted average of the Germany target two net balance, obviously. Because if the euro system would collapse, maybe that nobody wants to repay back their debts, you know, for the euro system, apart from the gold reserves. After all these bad news or implications, let's see how to restore the uniqueness of the eurozone interest rate structure. Because, you know, exit from the crisis starts from this point. And in my opinion, we have to look at the other currency area to learn something. And in this case, look at the United States of America. And I realize some differences. You know, for the public debt held by the European central banks, actually peanuts, with respect to what the Federal Reserve held, we pay interest. We, because only Gypsy has more or less public debt in the euro, the European Central Banks, something like 10 billion euro, that then the European Central Banks distributes like the dividends to the other central banks. So, it's interesting. The European Central Bank, with the securities market program, helps the gypsy countries, and the help consists in buying bonds where the countries that they have helped pays money to the European Central Bank, that is their central bank actually, and then the central bank distributes this money towards the other European, the other central banks, namely the Bundesbank. Every year we give something like 2 billion of euro for this. But in US, it's not that the mechanism. In the United States of America, they don't pay interest towards the Federal Reserve. The reason is clear. We are in the same boat, but not with the lion and the ships. We are in the same boat, all ships. It's a big difference. And another big difference. In US, the Federal Reserve, with a total asset of 4,300 billion of dollar, have 4,000 of public debts in their assets. Yes, something is treasury, something are the mortgage vacant securities of Freddie Mae and Fannie Mae, but forgive me, these are completely nationalized, so it can be considered as public debts. Another point, no gold reserves within the Federal Reserve. The 18 billion of dollars of gold reserves are within the treasury. The balance of the European Central Bank, you know, is like a balance of a very thin person. It's 2,000 billion of euro in total, 350 gold reserves, 350, US 18, okay? And only 300 billion of govies, more or less. So it's an enormous difference. But what I repeat is incredible is that we pay interest to the central bank. So, my proposal, since I know that to change the European treaty it would require a decade, so actually I cannot follow our colleagues, economists in Germany that say to make these things we have to change the treaty. No, please. We can make an intergovernment agreement like the fiscal compact. We did it. It's not a modification of the treaty. It's just an agreement. Okay? We could make an agreement where the European countries does not pay interest to the central banks. Immediately, 10 billion of euro on a yearly basis for the countries that has problem, because this money are paid by the gypsies, would be immediately free for investment. And everybody knows that the collapse in the gross domestic product of Gypsy is due to investment component. It's just a simple breakdown. But obviously this is just one signal that anyway is important for financial markets. Because any time the financial markets has received a signal of Eurozone reaggregation, they immediately behave coherently. Because in financial markets, they bet money. If they bet in the wrong direction, they lose money. If there is a will of convergence, you have to bet on convergence to gain money. Like when the euro was born, with the convergence trade, they were selling the BTP and buy the bond in order to converge the interest rate and structure. It has already happened. And also after the OMT, it happens. Now we live at 150 of spread, not 500. So this is an important signal for the market, but it's not enough. It's a first step. Because in my opinion, the second step is not to cancel the debt, so these things, because there is no way, but to freeze the debt for 4,000 billion of euro within the European Central Bank with a long-dated bond is exactly what has happened in the US. We could do this. It's like a big securities market program that does not pay interest. That any time a country needs to refinance its debt instead of being exposed to the dynamic of the market, is the central bank that refinances the debt. With the long-dated bond, 30 years, 40 years, look at the term structure of the US Treasury. It's in this way, from 0 months to 40 years. If you go on Bloomberg, it goes in this way. It goes down at 4 years, then it's stable, and then at 30 years it has a peak. With the quantitative easing, the Federal Reserve, in agreement with the government, has changed the term structure of the debt, because it is clear. If you freeze debt and you don't pay interest, you give money to the real economy. In Italy, we pay 90 billion of euro of interest every year. Germany pays half of this amount for its public debt refinancing every year. This is normal? No. If we live in the same currency area, if a country does not pay interest to refinance its debt, also the others should behave in the same way. Due to the phenomenon of negative interest rate and flight to quality to the Bund, Germany is refinancing its debt at zero cost. So my proposal is just to say that the European Central Bank should make a convergence of the Eurozone by allowing all the Eurozone countries to not pay interest rate. And since I don't want any kind of gift from nobody, but just you know, something that is fair. These 4,000 billions of euro should be, you know, should be, let's say, determined the pro quota for each Eurozone member countries according to their GDP. So in other words, I'm not asking to receive more debt refinancing than Germany, because I will use the GDP as a numerator. So Germany will receive more than 1,000 billion of its debt refinanced in that way. For more than 4 years, they will not make any auctions in the market. Italy has a smaller GDP, only 600. Only 800, 600, no, 600 is Italy, 800 is France, 400 is Spain. So we use the GDP as a numerator, not the debt like, you know, in other solutions like the Eurobond. Because obviously Germany has an important argument in opposition to the Eurobond. That in the Eurobond you want to mutualize the difference between 135% and 60% within the ratio of the GDP, debt over GDP, for example, for Italy. And so Germany say, why I should mutualize only 10% of my debt and you have to mutualize 60% of debt? No, because in that case the numerator is a debt. By this With this solution, we would bring our European Central Bank to have eventually a balance sheet, let's say comparable with the one of the Federal Reserve, and still we have 350 billion of gold reserves that they don't have. But what is more relevant is that we put all the countries in the condition to reduce the cost for the financing of their public debts, and we could have a lot of money to invest and maybe, if needed, also to respect the fiscal compact that now cannot be respected. But if you are in the condition to have 50, 60 billion of euro every year free for investment and for reducing your debt, you are, as a country, put in the condition, in this moment I'm speaking about Italy, to relaunch the economy and to cover, also to respect the rules of the European Treaty. Let me summarize the proposal. The European Public Debt Refinancing Program would require averagely for the Eurozone countries more than 3 years and involve about 4,000 billion of euro. Look, it's not a big amount of money, because the atros was 1,000. The quantitative easing was 1,000 billion, what will be done in the next days. We are speaking about 4,000 billion of euro in the next 4 years, more or less. This program would interrupt the public debt auctions for the Eurozone, so no speculation could be conducted on our Eurozone debt for the next 4 years. And obviously this would support the convergence of the interest rate term structure towards one level. The interruption in paying interest on public debts held by the European Central Bank would level the European Zone member country to Germany. It's not correct that only Germany pays zero in refinancing its debt. And in this way, we can also compensate the phenomenon of the flight to quality, of the negative interest rate, and so on. The cost of interest would reduce on a yearly basis, because every year, for example, Italy would refinance 350 billion of euro of debt. And so in the first year, you would reduce by 10 billion of euro your cost of interest, the second year, 20 billion, and so on. And so you will be able to have a growing amount of money over time to relaunch the economy and to respect the treaty as well. So I think that these are more or less, this is a possibility, at least to be discussed. In my opinion, it is fair. I don't see, but I'm open to discuss, and actually I would like to have your opinion, what could be the counterindications. But definitely, if Germany, also in this case, would say no, since they have the highest advantage in terms of debt to be refinanced, in terms of options cancelled from the market, and so on, in my opinion, the only reason is that since they are getting advantage from this situation, as I have shown very, I hope, clear in these slides today, it is clear that they are not moving towards the existence of euro, and so it is the time for a plan B. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for this very optimistic speech. And now do we have questions? Yes, there is one question here, and then be short so that we can take more.
First of all, thank you very much for your very clear presentations for this session. It's very, very intuitive, I mean, for not interpretation, I'd say. The first question is this. When you ask to increase the share, you know, of bonds held by the central bank, are you basically you're implicitly assuming that the central bank asked for the money. So it's a kind of, amazing, no? Hooks in Europe fear this because of some kind of inflation problems that will come in the future. So, what's your opinion about this possibility that printing money or quantitative easing, introducing some form of quantitative easing, bring inflation into the Eurozone? I know that in this moment in time, talking about inflation is out of fashion because we are clearly in inflation. But since we are talking about medium term, this could be a solution. And a second question, just like it goes in your presentation of another solution proposed by Paris and others, which they talk about this possibility of not paying interest in case the central bank would buy most from the market. Okay? I don't know if you know this older solution, but it seems a bit close. If you know this, what's the difference between your solution?
Do you prefer to answer one by one or collectively?
Thank you for the presentation. I just would like to ask maybe already what is your plan B? Because I think if everything happens as it happens and as you show it clearly, and maybe also I think you should show the same slides also in Germany, maybe, because not everybody is aware of what happens in financial market. And what is the plan B? Because I think if something was set up in this way and our politician, Italian politician, other European politician agreed or maybe accepted, because I hope they read the treaty when they signed, they were aware of what were the implications, as you call it. So basically I think it's actually impossible that Germany, or if it was another country, it was the same, that has advantages. So what is their incentives to adopt your solution? I think it's just that the euro will not break up, but who would say that with the euro break up, they will not have advantage as well? So if everything happens, it was because with the lira and marco, we had Italy has advantage with the export, with the devaluation of the currency, and it was possible to export more for us. Now, how you see, how you show from the graph, the exports are decreasing, and German exports are increasing. So I would ask if you have also already a plan B, like to gain again the currency sovereignty, or at least a control of the government. Thank you.
Yes.
You laid out for us in a very clear way, from an economic point of view, what you call plan A and plan B. If you look politically on the Eurozone, would you take here in front of us a chance for a risk and trying to predict where indeed or what is going to happen? I mean, is the Eurozone going indeed in the direction of adapting what you call it, plan B, plan A, and everything? What can you say about it?
Okay,
Firstly, thanks for your questions. That allows me to say something more and hope to satisfy with my answers your request. Yes, I'm worried about the problem of inflation because the debt would not be cancelled, just frozen within the balance sheet here, like in the Federal Reserve, and we know that at the moment the Federal Reserve is around 4% of inflation. So we cannot say that the 4,000 billion of public debt within the assets of the Federal Reserve is equal to 4% of inflation, but at the moment in the US that is a problem. Actually, I don't care about inflation because, in my opinion, also the level of 2% is something that, when it's been signed, maybe that a lot of neurons of the people that signed the agreement were completely exhausted. And that is a point. But anyway, since I'm worried about it, I think that partially my proposal hedges this problem because it's gradual. It's a gradual. So you can monitor what happens. Because you refinance is not a general purchase within the market, like the securities market program. I just tell to the governments that they will never do an auction anymore for the next 4 years. That's it. So in 1 year they could finance 1,000 billion, they will see what would be the inflation. At a certain point in time they could also stop, you know, the program. Or they could revise this level of 2%. I mean, that is not, in my opinion, is not compatible with the present level. We don't live anymore in the moment in which the treaty was signed. At that time, the average of the public debt of the GDP was 60%. Now the average in Europe is 80%. The figures are changing. So they have written the treaty in a way that you cannot move, you cannot change. But thanks to this flexibility in the intergovernmental agreement, we could do something. So far, in my opinion, we have used this tool only to play in opposition to the Eurozone, because the fiscal compact has been signed, in my opinion, has been signed through the six-pack in October 2011, in my opinion, without understanding that in that way we were entering in a tunnel without any kind of exits. When I wrote in my book La Moneta and Computer in a very strong way this aspect, I was alone. Now everybody are saying this because the figures are behind the corner. About the other proposal, please send me the material because actually I was not aware about that because actually it's something that I proposed more or less last year, but I'm not aware, so I cannot, but I'm keen to receive the material and then we can have a bilateral session to discuss in order to not escape from this request. The plan B, it's clear that the plan B is the Euro breakup. But you know, in these ways is a very slow agony. I mean, it is quite clear. In these last months, also Germany is experiencing some reduction in the gross domestic product, but just because they are reorienting their trade surplus. I show you. They have understood that the internal Eurozone demand is exhausted and they are moving outside. I don't know if they will, it seems that they are able to do this by looking at these preliminary figures, but to understand this worldwide vendor financing cycle, we need another year and a half to understand if they will be able to completely reorientate after that they have, you know, exhaust also France, because this is what is happening. They have finished with Italy, Spain, Greece, etc. Now they are working hard on France. The point is that, in my opinion, what is going to happen? We can be lucky and this reorientation of the trade surplus would not work. And so also Germany would remain, you know, in a situation not completely satisfactory. And so instead of pushing the European Central Bank only to deleverage their credit risk as they are doing with this quantitative easing, that never can buy government bonds, it's incredible in this moment, but you know, this is what will happen. Actually, I make unfortunately this forecast 4 months ago that it would have finished in this way, but we will see. I hope to be completely contradicted in the next hours. But in that case, in my opinion, the only thing that we can do is to present the trend, is to present concretely the trend. And I don't have the proof for what I'm saying, but in my opinion, we get the spreadsheet and the OMT, in my opinion, by trending, you know, by saying that we do have left the euro area, because in January 2012, 2013, sorry, because, you know, in a moment in which the target to net balance showed that Germany is still around 500 billion of euro, and you have 200 billion of this money, and you say, okay, you don't want to implement a similar solution? Forget about this 200 billion. Because obviously, this is the only thing that you do. Okay, they has a guarantee, the gold of the Bank of Italy that is there. Yes, I know that there are some people that thinks that that gold can be used for some restructuring plan. Unfortunately, they have not studied that that gold is dedicated to the euro system. But the fantasy is still present during the summer for solution to restructure our debts. But I believe that that is the only point, that if I could be Germany, we would make you know, the threat of leaving the Eurozone. They can use our gold as a warranty. Obviously, we will experience incredible, in my opinion, issues, problems in terms of refinancing the debt, an incredible devaluation. We would, I'm not in favor of the euro breakup, but at a certain point, we need also to bring these arguments on those tables. And unfortunately, I don't know if these arguments are on those tables. I have read several reports of the famous economist Sin, where he describes this euro crisis. Exactly the opposite I've done. The opposite. The point is that I show all these figures, these facts. Please contradict me on these facts. There are no conjectures here. These are easy trends, capital flows, inflows, outflows, so this is what is happening. So instead, my impression also by hearing politicians when they discuss within the European institutions, I continue to hear only these kind of things. We will respect all the treaties. But remember that also Germany has been helped during the union of the two Germanies. This is the only kind of things that we have put on the table, at least for what I can read on the newspapers, what I can hear from the media. Instead, in my opinion, it should be started to discuss about these points. Germany has implemented a bank financing scheme by using the advantage of its position. We entered in this currency union with an exchange rate that was exactly more or less the Deutschmark. That way they were put in the condition to exploit this situation. The German Bund the German public debt refinancing happens at zero cost. It's not correct. We pay the interest and it does not happen with the Federal Reserve, with the Bank of Japan. In my opinion, if these aspects I would start to hear within the discussions, first of all, we would have more arguments in order to get some further results within the Eurozone architecture. Otherwise, it is clear that sooner or later we will finish. But it is clear that from the Germans' point of view, it's better that it will happen later. Because thinking if the 1st of December 2012, when the net target to balance was 800 billion of euro, the euro would have broken up. Without the help of the ELTROs, the German banking system would collapse immediately. Immediately! And now, and at that time, we could see half of our public debt was outside Italy at that time. Now it's no longer this the picture. We have nationalized the debt. So, you know, it is also a question of the moment in which you could do. Definitely, if I would have seen this story, I will say now a strong sentence, maybe that the 1st of December 2012 I would be in perfect agreement with Mr. King. The game is over. Yes. Now it's a little bit different, because the public debt is in a large part within our country, the same thing in the other Eurozone countries. The target to net balance goes down. So, I mean, it's not easy to make this kind of... But anyway, we have to increase, and for this reason I accept also this invitation, and I want that this idea at least are discussed. It's important that these aspects are discussed and put on the table correctly.
Well, thank you. I will ask it. Yes, I have a question, and then I will give you the floor. There are no Germans here. Yes, yeah, there are. Yeah, but yeah. I will try to play the German. I perfectly agree with you, of course, but, I mean, you forget the sentiments. Germans would say that there is virtue also to take into account. I mean, those flows that have gone to the pigs, gypsies, were the inevitable result of their surpluses. Mm? If you want to go on having surpluses, you have to finance what you call the vendor. This is a model that Germany was also playing in the 80s, giving long-term loans in order that people could buy their capital goods. So it's a play that is going on. Seems wrong, eh? But then they would say, well, okay, and then you say, look at the differential in inflation. And they would answer, well, okay, but this is, once again, virtue. You are not virtuous. You have been giving high wages. You are not having low productivity. So what's wrong? I mean, we are not paying interest because we are in heaven. Well, that's, once again, I mean, you are asking us, it's a very, very common, you are asking us to be less virtuous. Last but not least, we are going to implement this, and then you stop doing your structural reforms that you need to do, and so the play goes on again. So, I think that we have to take these observations also into account and prepare an answer. Because otherwise, the Germans or the creditor countries won't understand that their virtue is also a problem when you are in a common area and in a common market. So this is what. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this very interesting lecture, which shows quite well the dysfunctions of the euro system as it is at this time. And I think also Germans are aware of the fact that lending is cheapest for Germans and the most expensive for Southern Europeans at this time. And of course, this cannot be the goal of that system. I'm unfortunately not an economist, but a scientist. I would like to focus on the political dimension of, let's say, macroeconomic policies, the national and the European level. And I would say if we look at the national level, we can of course see that there are many different national policy ideologies or traditions that we have. Germans stick very much to the idea of auto-liberalism. That means you have a legal framework for the market and you have not so much public spending compared to what's going on in the private sector. And at least I know France has another totally different model of industrial policies, of the state, of public interventions. And of course, these models contradict each other. And so I would like to focus more on the reasons of this kind of gap and of would-be conspiracy Germans against the others also. I don't think, or at least I am as naive to hope that it's not the case, but what I see, we have no common philosophy on macroeconomic policies, already between nations, and it's a tragedy that just the German-French couple is so diverse in that respect. And I think France is now trying to turn that around a little bit towards these structural reforms, policies, and Germany still lacks the consciousness of being aware that France perhaps needs more fresh money also to do something with the economy. So there must be a kind of learning effect in the German public about the needs of southern European countries and France as well. Because if France fails, Europe will fail anyway. That would have been my question. When will France fail in the model that you have proposed? But the other problem is, how can we now have a synthesis of European macroeconomic policy where we bring together parts of both traditions, public spending, public intervention, and order liberalism? Because this is where the solution must be made. I think the model that you suggest could help as a kind of easing of pressure on the southern countries. But what we definitely need is that let's say politicians at the European level and at the national level cooperate much more in terms of developing a European economic policy, because that's the construction, the deficit in the euro that we have, which also leads to this spread. I think 2008 or 2009, investors discovered, oh, they are so different. And in Greece, of course, a lot of public spending did not go into so many productive things. So maybe there must be something changed. But on the other hand, of course, as a German, I can see and I can feel there is a kind of taste of German hegemony in the Eurozone, and we have to prevent this, because this will lead to a renationalization of politics and to a breakup of not only of the Euro, but of the EU perhaps in itself. And that's the last thing which could be in the interest of Germans, because Germans want to unite as part of the United European Union. So perhaps German policymakers are not aware of the risk which goes along with the current equilibrium. But the question is, what is the macroeconomic policy and responsibility of the national government and of the European political level?
Okay. Thank you very much, Mirza. Thank you very much for your presentation. Very, very clear. And I just recorded in my paper the great trouble of the euro area, that where the Greece are clear monetary policy related to economic policy, related to fiscal policy. In terms of fiscal policy, we have only strong limits to spending and limits to debt and deficit, but nothing more. I think that your proposal is very, very interesting, but it's not a matter of agreement. It's a matter of institutional way to intend our framework. And so your benchmark is the Federal Reserve. Federal Reserve is a central bank really and completed in its mission, not as our bank. So the trouble is that it's serious, because Mario Draghi tried to do what he can do. You talk about unconventional monetary instruments, unconventional. So the conventional are the proper one of a central bank, but our is not a central bank. Before going on in the process, we have to fix the shared rules. Monetary policy and economic fundamentals, because our GDP going decrease year after year, month after month, so we are in recession, and this is the fundamental thing to face, and this all.
Okay, Maria Caterina.
Yes, just a question, just a curiosity. I was wondering about the kind of model, forecasting model that you're using, quantitative analysis that you need to support your conclusions, your results. And I might have missed part of the presentation, I apologize for this. So yes, that's the question.
Any more questions?
Thanks again. I'm really glad about this further consideration, because again, it allows me to contribute, to say other things that I think are important and missed so far during the presentation. Yes, the German sentiment, you are right, that is a problem, but in my opinion, the first thing is to share the reality as it is. This is the starting point. Instead, what I see, and I'm not happy about it, are papers and documents produced at a very high level where the reality is misspecified. I have read papers when the securities market program is described as a debt monetization. This is false. But famous German economist has written this. Okay? So the point is that, in my opinion, the situation in our world is clear. When you mix countries within the same currency area that are, as you were saying, very different, like it was in the United States of America, or you have a very big federal balance in order that you can compensate the imbalances, or you would experience what we have seen in Italy between the north and the south, what you have experienced in Germany between the eastern part and the western part. This is a fact. This is a fact. So, it's important to share these points. And then, once these points are clear, my example, I like this example, about the glass of plastic. Okay, yes, maybe that the factory that in Umbria was producing the glass of plastic were not really efficient. Maybe. But they have been, what the factory is not efficient in Italy, have been completely, you know, destroyed in the last 5-6 years. So the inefficiency is no longer present because due to the interest that, you know, that you have to pay, a large quota of our industry that, okay, was not efficient or inefficient, was simply in the market and sells product that was a perfect, you know, substitutes with respect to others. And they were completely excluded just by the fact that the financial phenomenon was there. In Greece, we had the most important aluminium factory after the one present in Germany, once upon a time. With the spread, that factory was completely exhausted. It was an important source for the GDP. Not the most important, but it was there. And now you want to tell me that in the aluminium production it's a problem of technology or quality. The problem is that once you ask your factory to pay 50% of interest rate, how can you compete? What we are talking about. Our production of paper of Cartier Burgo, Electrolux in the north of Italy, we are speaking about a very mature markets, and this is the cycle I like to call fixed cost, variable cost, then you close. What happens? Firstly, they reduce the line of production. Please, check what I'm saying within these Italian factories, but not only in Italy. Firstly, they cut the line productions that are not really efficient. But I repeat, they are not efficient for a problem of interest. It's a financial problem. So firstly, it arrives a good managing director that has the big idea to, you know, put the balance sheet in order by cutting the line production. This is the first decision. Then there is the second phase. The second phase is that obviously, since there is a relationship between the fixed cost and the variable cost. This could help you for 1 year, 2 years of balance sheets. Then they reduce the salaries. They make this fantastic agreement in order to reduce, to put you in a position that you are no longer, you know, a stable employee, whatever. And just to give you some figures that I know very well from the most important Italian unions, the CGL, because I have seen some figures from their analysis. In Germany, the net wage that per hours a worker on a production line receive is 8.5 euro per hour, net in the pocket. This is some statistic that I have read exactly yesterday during a meeting. The General Secretariat of FIOM told me, Rizzolandini told me, if at least 50% of our workers would receive 80.5 euro in their pocket, I would be not happy more. Because in Italy, he told me that 80% of the workers in the production line receive in average 6 euro per hour. So it's not also that the problem. Yes, we have a problem on labor productivity. But please, how the labor productivity is computed? I don't want to make the point, but is as a numerator and a denominator. Okay, in Italy we have the problem that the labor is a little bit rigid. So in this ratio, the denominator remains there and the numerator goes down because you don't sell the products. So if you don't sell, the numerator goes down, the denominator is there. And not because we have the article in 18, please. Okay? And so the labor productivity goes down. But we have to understand that all these indexes, all these figures are no longer adequate for the story that we are living. And then, so by coming to your considerations that, let me summarize, because what our German friend and US said can be, you know, summarized maybe in the same answer. The European countries are completely different, but also the states of the United States of America are completely different. Completely. In California, we have also an actor that has been the governor for a lot of years with incredible policy measures. He brought California to bankruptcy, and it could be actually forever. Okay. So the point is that, in my opinion, we can live with these differences, but we have to start to use finance in our favor. Finance is a fundamental boost. Think about the euro when it was born. Without finance, forget it. It is merit of the convergency trades, the financial institutions that start to sell the govies with higher interest rate and buy the ones with lower interest rate. And we had the unique interest rate structure. So the point is that we have to sit down on the table and say, what are the key steps, the key, let's say, the key aspects of the Eurozone? And we don't have to go very far from our book of economics. I have studied in economics one currency, one interest rate structure. First point, if you have a fixed exchange rate regime, you need transfer of money in order to balance these aspects between the strong country and the weak country. Oh, it's Dornbusch Fischer. It's not something very far from. Instead, since every day we receive, today the spread is 150, today the spread is 180, yesterday it was 170, we have the labor reforms and now the spread is 200. But these are figures, unfortunately they have three figures, otherwise I could play at the lottery, you know? That is the point. So, let me be provocative. The point is that we have to realize that, I understand, there is the virtue of the German people, the flight to quality represents this virtue. No, the flight to quality represents the fact that at the moment, since the Eurozone is not evaluated by financial markets as a unique area, but as a group of people that stays together, like Metternich, Prince, defined Italy several centuries ago, like a geographic representation. This is Europe at the moment, but unfortunately we don't have the Prince Metternich. The point is that we have to move one step beyond and say, these are the basis. Then, sooner or later, we will have a federal balance, like in US. We will have a transfer between the South and the North because we will believe and we will live as European citizens and not like German citizens, Italian citizens, Spanish citizens. But we have to make this step further. And so these are two pieces. We don't have to pay interest to the central bank. This is not something that we have to discuss. This is wrong at the beginning. I understand and agree with you. It's also wrong that the European Central Bank is not the central bank with all the instruments. Okay, but to change this we need a decade. Okay, a decade. But at least we start from some very easy points. There is no reason for paying interest. We have to say to the market that we believe in the Eurozone. We believe to become European citizens. And this preliminaries of what I call the European refinancing program is the basis. It's not correct that within Europe, from Berlin or from Paris, we could accept that another country like Greece is completely exposed to the financial markets, let's say, boosting pressure, squeezing. But you know that the Greek debt is completely in foreign law. It's something that should not be admittable within the Eurozone. So the debt of Euro of Greek has been restructuring because it was of national law. Now we come back to the same level before the structuring with a difference. That debt is not in national legislation. So in other words, Greece has given all the sovereignty of its debt towards financial institutions. In a European logic, this should not be admittable, because that debt is part of the Eurozone. Instead, we read on all the European newspapers, find me an article that say the opposite, that Greek, with the austerity, has eventually be able to refinance his debt on the market with reasonable interest rate. False. 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 If we are not able to say the situation like it is, in my opinion, we cannot move. About the quantitative analysis, coming back to the last question, believe me, it's just algebra. There is no forecast. It's pure algebra. Nothing more than that.
Are there any other questions or we are convinced? So, well, we thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And we hope that this project of you has good hearings in where it
should be right places.
In the right places, and we hope we don't need a plan B.
Absolutely.
Okay, so